My name again is Andre Waller, and just so happy that you are joining us again today. Our subject today will be Let It Rain. But before we begin our subject matter, let us begin with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we want to thank you for your grace and your tender mercy towards us. We want to thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus, and for the gift of your Holy Spirit. We want to thank you for forgiving us for our sins. And now as we study, Father, we just ask for the gift of your Holy Spirit, which is the only effectual teacher of truth. And we ask, Father, that you link our hearts with your heart and our mind with your mind, that we may understand the deep things of God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to begin in the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 16, and we're going to begin reading at verse number 1. 1 Samuel 16 and verse 1. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil, and go. I will send thee to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons." So if we're asking ourselves the question, who has provided himself a king? Well, God has provided himself a king among his sons. Notice what the Bible continues to say, looking now at verse number 6. "And it came to pass when they were come that he looked on Eliab and said, Surely the Lord's anointed is before me. But the Lord said unto Samuel, Look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him, for the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but God, what does he look? Well, he looks on the heart." Now, friends, I want you to know something. I want you to understand something. The Bible says that when the prophet Samuel came to see whether or not Eliab was a chosen of God, God refused Eliab. Well, here's my question. If God is going around the world and he's investigating and watching the people of God, and he comes to your name, I wonder, is God accepting your name or refusing your name? I wonder what it was in the life of Eliab that God said he could not use, or that he could not allow to be a representative of him as he was king. Now notice what the Bible goes on to say in verse number 8. "Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel, and said, Neither hath the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by, and he said, Neither hath the Lord chosen this. Again Jesse made 7 of his sons to pass before Samuel, and Samuel said unto Jesse, The Lord have not chosen these. And Samuel said unto Jesse, Are here all thy children? And he said, There remain of yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, Send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, and withal of beautiful countenance, and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Now please keep in mind, my friend, please keep this clear in your understanding. God has bypassed Eliab. God has bypassed Shammah. God has bypassed all the other brothers of David, and David wasn't even invited when Samuel came into the town. So what did they do? Samuel said, "Hey, I'm not going to sit down until you go get your son." And now David is taking care of the sheep. He is doing what I call country living, my friends. He is taking care of animals in the country-like setting. And now the Bible says in verse 13, "Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah." So keep this in mind as we're studying this particular point, that God anoints David with oil, and when he anoints him with oil, the Spirit of God comes upon him from that day forward. The Spirit of God comes upon him from that day going forward. Now watch a little closely. I want you to go now to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 2. 2 Samuel chapter 2. And we're going to begin reading. 2 Samuel chapter 2. Begin reading at verse number 2. It says, "So David went up thither and his two wives also, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, Nabal's wife, the Carmelite. And his men that were with him did David bring up, every man with his household, and they dwelt in the cities of Hebron. And the men of Judah came, and there they anointed David king over the house of Judah. And they told David, saying that men of Jabesh-Gilead were they that buried Saul. Let's get the point. Let's just get to the point. The point here is that the men of Judah came and anointed David to be king over them. Now, was David already anointed? Yes, he was. Who was he anointed by? He was anointed by Samuel. Samuel was the representative of God. Was David anointed with a lot of people around him or a little bit? Well, it was only a small group. That was his brothers. And now he's being anointed by people that recognize the abilities of David's kingship, and they are subjecting themselves to David's kingship. I want you to go a little further with me to 2 Samuel chapter 5. 2 Samuel chapter 5. And we're beginning now at verse number 1. Please note here what the Bible says. Then came all the tribes of Israel to David unto Hebron, and spake, saying, behold, we are thy bone and thy flesh. Also in time past, when Saul was king over us, thou was he that led us out and brought us in Israel. And the Lord said to thee, thou shalt feed my people Israel, and thou shalt be a captain over Israel. You know that idea of feed my people? It's the same thing of feed my sheep. Same idea. When David was a little boy taking care of those sheep in the pasture, he was actually being trained to be king. Don't despise those small beginnings, my friends. The Bible goes on to say, so all the elders of Israel, verse 3, came to the king to Hebron, and King David made a league with them. He made a covenant with them in Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. So how many times has David been anointed? Well, that would be 3 times. David has been anointed 3 times. Once by Samuel, who's a representative of God amongst his brethren. Secondly, by Judah, who set all their men under him because they wanted the benefits of David's kingship. Lastly, we have the people of Israel who enter into a covenant with him, and they said something interesting. You are bone of our bone. You are flesh of our flesh. You are one of us. This is very important to keep in mind, for David is a symbol of someone else, and I'm going to talk about that in a few moments. But please keep in mind that David has been anointed 3 different times. Well, let's go a little further in our discussion together. I want you now to go to 2 Samuel, 2 Samuel chapter 7. David has been anointed 3 times. David is now receiving a word from the Lord. In verse 12, 2 Samuel 7 verse 12, the Bible says, and when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and will establish his kingdom. So someone's going to come out from the bowels of David, from his loins, and they are going to have an established kingdom. Verse 13, he shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. How long is this kingdom supposed to last? That's right, it's supposed to last forever. And then it goes on to say, I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the children of men. But my mercy shall not depart away from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away from thee. And thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. So here's a quiz. I love quizzes because I love to teach the word. Question. How long is this kingdom supposed to last? Your answer? Forever. Is that right? Forever. The kingdom is supposed to last forever. So let's review for a few moments. Let's keep these thoughts right before us because we're going to move from point to point as we're going in this next hour. It says there are 3 anointings for David. 3 anointings for David. There had to be a recognition of David's leadership. There had to be a recognition of David's leadership if they're going to come under his rulership and receive his benefits. Do you hear what I just said? So in other words, everyone had to recognize that David had a special anointing on him, and then they submitted themselves in a covenant relationship Therefore, David would fight for them and lead for them and make decisions for them because they realized that God's special anointing was on him. The other point that we want to bring out is that David's kingdom, this kingdom, would last forever and it would be given to another. Now let's go a little further. I want to go a little further. I want to go to the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation. Our time is running already. I know it is. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading at verse number 7. Revelation chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading at verse number 7. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and no man openeth." Do you understand what I'm reading to you? So there's a key. The key is the key of David, and there's a door. The door is open, and none man can shut, and no man can open. It's the key of David. Now let's just put this picture in your mind. When someone holds a key, the key is usually in the hand. There's a key. If you go to open your door today, if you go home, you want to open your door, you usually have a key in your hand, and you put the key into the lock, and you turn that lock, and you open that door. Is that right? It's a key to a door. It's a key to a room. Now watch carefully. I want you now to go to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, chapter 22. Isaiah, chapter 22, and beginning at verse number 21. Isaiah 22, and beginning at verse 21. The Bible says, "And I will clothe him with thy robe, and strengthen him with thy girdle. And I will commit thy government into his hand, and he shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, to the house of Judah." Where's the government at? Well, the government is in his hand. Now watch this, verse 22. "And the key of the house of David will I lay on his shoulder. So he shall open and none shall shut, and he shall shut and none shall open." So remember, in Revelation, the key was in his hand. Now in Isaiah 22, the key is on his shoulder, and the government is in his hand. Let's go to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9, and we're looking now at verse number 6. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse number 6. Notice what the Bible says. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his" what? "Upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts has spoken this." Now, please note that in this verse, the government is on his shoulder. In the previous verse, the government was in his hand. And the key was on the shoulder. But in Revelation chapter 1, or Revelation chapter 3, the key is in his hand. Do you see what we're talking about, brothers and sisters? That God has a wonderful plan here for David's kingdom. The kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and the key is the key to a kingdom. You ever heard about keys to the city? Keys to the city. Someone who is of great honor and great note has keys to the city. These keys are a key to the kingdom. Let's go to the book of Revelation. The book of Daniel. Book of Daniel. We're going to begin reading at verse number chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7, verse number 13. Daniel chapter 7, verse number 13. We're going to begin reading. The Bible says, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed." Now, friends, this is very interesting. Jesus, in Daniel 7:13, is going in to receive a kingdom. Jesus is going in to receive a kingdom. So when we read in Revelation chapter 3 that Jesus had a key to open a door, it was the door that opened to the reception of a kingdom. Keep it in mind. It was a door that was open to a kingdom. What kind of kingdom is it? It's an everlasting dominion. It will never be destroyed. Now, we're going to put this thought to the side for a few moments, so don't forget what we just covered. We're going to go now to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 11. Deuteronomy chapter 11. And we're going to begin reading at verse number 11. And it's going to appear as if we're talking about something very, very different, but we're talking about the same thing. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, and beginning at verse number 11, the Bible says, "But the land whether you go to possess it is a land of hills and valleys, and drink of water of the rain of heaven, a land which the Lord thy God careth for. The eyes of the Lord thy God are always upon it, from the beginning of the year even unto the end of the year. And it shall come to pass, if ye shall hearken diligently unto my commandments, which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, that I will give you the rain of your land in his due season, the first rain and the latter rain, that thou mayest gather in thy corn and thy wine and thine oil." Now, friends, please pay close attention. What is the condition that God sets before his people in order for them to receive the rain, the early and latter rain? And though I'm talking about literal rain here, I'm actually talking about a whole nother principle of rain. But nonetheless, what is the condition that God sets for his people in order to receive the early and latter rains? The Bible says again, verse 13, "And it shall come to pass, if ye shall hearken diligently unto my commandments." Tell this before, but I remember when I was little, my dad, very good man, I love my daddy. My dad was a very strict man at some points. And I was washing dishes one day, and I was kind of just halfway doing my job washing those dishes. And my dad went into the kitchen after I was done and grabbed a fork to prepare to eat. And when he picked up that fork and he looked at the fork, the food was all inside the fork. And my dad called me into the kitchen. He said, "Andre, come here." So I came in and he said, "Andre, you see this fork?" And my dad proceeded to give me a lecture about my whole life on this one fork. I mean, he went on for about 20 minutes about this fork in my life. And at that time, I didn't understand anything about what he was talking about my life in this fork. But now being older, I definitely understand. But my dad did something I'll never forget, which altered my life. My dad said, "Andre, I love you. What I want you to do right now, I want you to take every dish out of the cabinet, every bowl, every plate, every glass, every pot, every pan, every piece of silverware. I want you to wash everything over again." Man, you know, I was upset. I was completely upset that my dad would make me wash every dish again. But let me tell you something. From that day forward, I hearkened diligently unto my dad's commandments. Do you understand what I'm saying? When I washed the fork, I made sure I held that fork, and I washed in between that fork. I would get my glasses, and I would put them up to the light to make sure there's no water spots in them. I would make sure I would hearken diligently unto the commandment of my father. Not one time from that day forward did my dad ever find any dirty fork or any dirty plate. Even to this day, I'll just be happy to tell you, you come to my house, I have some clean dishes. It's because God says, hearken diligently. And I use that as an example so you can understand that when we're hearkening diligently, we're not skipping over something God says. We're paying attention to the details and making sure that we are following after. Now, if we don't, notice what the Bible says will happen. Beginning at verse number 16, it says, "Take heed to yourselves, that your heart be not deceived, and ye turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. And then the Lord's wrath be kindled against you, and he shut up the heaven, that there be no rain, and that the land yield not her fruit, unless ye perish quickly from off the good land which the Lord God giveth you." Do you see it, friends? Do you see how God, in his mercy, is giving conditions and letting us know the conditions for the reception of the rain? This is not talking. This, though it is talking about real rain, it's talking about a spiritual rain as well. I want you to go to the book of Hosea. The book of Hosea, chapter 6. Hosea chapter 6, and we're going to begin reading Hosea 6 in verse 3. Hosea chapter 6 and verse number 3. Please notice here what the Bible says. Hosea 6, just passed it. Hosea 6 and verse 3. The Bible says, "Then shall ye know, if ye follow on to know the Lord, his going forth is prepared as the morning. He shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth." So God is going to come unto us as the rain, the former and latter rain, which means this then, the same conditions that existed for the reception of the rain, the same conditions that existed for the rain to come and fall for their crops is the same condition needed for the people of God to receive God when he comes as the rain. In fact, notice what the Bible says in Hosea chapter 10 and verse 12. The Bible says, "Sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain what? Rain righteousness upon you." It's time to seek the Lord until he comes and rains righteousness upon you. Remember now, he's going to come as the rain. Now he's saying he's going to rain righteousness upon us. Well, let's go a little further with this. I want to go to the book of Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 10. Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 1. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. So the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to everyone grass in the field." Okay, here's another point. We are to ask for rain in the time of the latter rain. We are to ask for it in its time. But if you don't know what time it is, you don't know what you're asking for. And if you're asking for the rain when it's not time for it to rain, that'll be a problem as well. We need to ask for the rain in the time of the latter rain. Now, I remember a story. The story is of Elijah. You know that story. And they had that golden calf or that they were dancing around and jumping around. And Elijah rebuked the worshipers of Baal. Nonetheless, when that was over and God rained down fire on behalf of Elijah, God had already said it's going to rain. But do you know what Elijah did? Elijah went and prayed as if God was dependent upon his prayers in order for it to rain. He knew that God already told him it was going to rain, but Elijah still went and prayed anyway because he knew that it still needed to be asked for even though it was time for it. Why is it that the people of God are not asking for rain in the time of the latter rain? Is it because they don't know what time it is? Or is it because they're not prepared to receive the rain? Or is it because they don't even know what the latter rain is? I don't know, friends, but we need to ask for the rain in the time of the latter rain. Let's go now to the book of Joel. The book of Joel. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 23. Joel chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 23. Please note here what the Bible says. It says, "Be glad then, ye children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month." Now, in this passage, if you have a study Bible, and your Bible says former rain, in that margin, it will say teacher of righteousness. And then in your margin there where it says moderately, it will say according to righteousness. So here you have it again. We'll read it with this interpretation in it. "Be glad then, ye children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the teacher of righteousness according to righteousness, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month." So this rain is a rain of righteousness, and it's God raining himself into or onto his people. Now watch. Keep this in mind. Rain comes based on a condition. Don't forget this. If you hearken diligently under the commandments of God. Rain helps things grow. Is that right? That's basic concept, basic premise. Rain helps things to grow. There is a time for the rain to fall. There's a time for the early rain, and there's a time for the latter rain. And the Bible now is calling or saying that there is a teacher of righteousness according to righteousness. And we need to find out who that teacher is. And this righteousness that when it comes, it's raining righteousness on the people that are receiving it. All right, with that in mind, we're going to put that aside for a moment. And I want to do a quick review for those who are listening. We first said that David was anointed how many times? Three times. He was anointed first by Samuel, then by the people of Judah, then by the men of Israel. Three times was he anointed, and the people entered into a covenant relationship and received the benefits of David's kingship. They recognized the anointing on David, and they subjected themselves to the kingship of David. Now, when they did that, they received those benefits. Now we just covered the conditions for the reception of rain. The rain representing righteousness being rained down, representing God coming upon his people and resting heavily upon them. Now, I want to go to a different point. Again, we're still talking about the same subject matter, but we're putting pieces of the puzzle and we're going to put it all together before it's all said and done. I want you now to go to the book of Luke, and we're going to Luke chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading at verse 21. Luke chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading at verse 21. Notice what the Bible says. The Bible says, "Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, and a voice came from heaven which says, Thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased." This was the first anointing of Jesus. This is the first anointing of Jesus, and this anointing was the ushering in of his prophetic work to declare the person and the character of God, to represent God amidst a people that had turned their back on God. But let's go a little further. I want you now to go to the book of John. John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Please note here what the Bible says in John chapter 14, and we're looking very specifically at verse number 15. The Bible says, "If ye love me," do what? "You keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever." Now I find it quite interesting that it says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Just like we saw that there was a condition to the reception of rain, if you hearken diligently unto my commandments, then it's going to rain. And it's interesting that if he says, "If you love me, keep my commandments," and the next thing we read is that he prays the Father, and the Father's going to send the Comforter. Now watch what happens. "Even the Spirit of truth," verse 17, "whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be." Now shall be is that past, present, or future? Well, shall be is definitely future. So it's telling me that the disciples have the Holy Spirit around them, but there's a point in time which the Holy Spirit is going to be inside of them, where the Holy Spirit is going to be dwelling inside their temples. This is very important, because there's a time for it. It didn't just say this is going to happen that day. It's going to be a certain time for it. Now watch. It says in verse number 18, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Doesn't that sound like Hosea 6 verse 3, where it says that the God of the heaven is going to come unto us like the rain? He says, "I will come to you yet a little while, and ye see me no more. But ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you." So there's a particular day that Jesus says, "I'm going to be in my Father, I am me and you, and you're going to know when that day is transpiring, because I'm going to come to you. I'm going to visit with you. I'm going to be inside of you." Watch what else happens. John chapter 16. John chapter 16, and we're reading now at verse number 7. It says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment." This is what the Holy Spirit is going to do. "Of sin, because they believe on me. of righteousness, because they go not, because I go to my Father and ye see me no more. Judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. Now, watch this. There are many of us who've had the Spirit of God around us, but have not had the Spirit of God within us. There are many that have walked and talked religion without the power of religion inside of them. And friends, I'm challenging you right now. Let's not live that life anymore. Let's not live a life of half-stepping Christianity. Let's live a life where God's presence lives within and he gives us victory over those sins that so easily beset us. Let's keep this in mind. Now, let's keep this in mind and let's go a little further. The Bible goes on to say, of sin, because ye see me, because they believe not on me. Now listen, when you pray for the Holy Ghost, when you pray for the Holy Spirit, it's not always going to feel good when he comes to you. You see, when the Holy Spirit comes, he reveals the reality of your depraved and wicked heart. When the Holy Spirit comes, he reveals our condition. Our condition, the Bible says, that our hearts are desperately wicked. Do you know what desperate looks like? I think I've described this over and over again, but desperate looks like the man that walks into a school and shoots 20 children. That's right. You thought that young man was evil all by himself. No, that young man is just as evil as any man, woman, boy, or girl that God's Spirit does not restrain. You thought it was evil for a man to be on a bus while a young man is sleeping with his headphones in his ear, and a man gets up and begins to chop off the neck of that boy for no apparent reason. And then when he's done, when the people see him chopping off the neck, nobody stops him from chopping the neck off. Nobody stops him. Nobody says, stop doing that. Everybody goes and seeks to save themselves and runs off the bus and lock the man in the bus with the boy. So the man goes back to the boy and severs the head off the boy and brings the head to the front of the bus. That's desperately wicked, my friends. And the Bible says your heart and my heart is that bad. See, if you don't believe what the word declares about your heart, you'll never receive the remedy for your condition. But the Bible says our heart is desperately wicked, friends. And friends, we need a new heart. We need a change of heart. We need a change of mind. We need a change. And the Holy Spirit needs to come within. I'm begging you, friends, soon God's Spirit is going to be withdrawn from this earth. In our previous topic, we talked about that beast from the bottomless pit and how there's great chaos about to come into the world. And yay, friends, that chaos is here. And unless God's Spirit lives within, we're in trouble. We must have God's Spirit living within each and every one of us. But we're not done yet. That's the work of the Spirit. The work of the Spirit is to reprove the word of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Now watch, verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. In other words, he's going to show you prophecy. He's going to tell you what's going to transpire. You don't have to guess about anything. There are certain things that God couldn't tell his disciples then, but he is telling his church today. His Spirit is being poured out today. The question is, are you receiving the indwelling of his Spirit, or are you continuing to live a life of rebellion, a life of sin, a life of witchcraft, a life of arrogancy, when God is seeking to change our lives from the inside out? I'm telling you, friends, what I'm sharing with you today, if you don't get what I'm sharing with you today, I'm afraid that you're in trouble. I'm afraid that you're in trouble. You need to listen carefully to what I'm sharing with you. Let's go a little further now to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. And we're looking at verse 44. Luke 24 and verse 44. The Bible says, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures. I wonder what kind of Bible study that was. I wonder what kind of study that was where Jesus begins to open the Bible and explain about himself from the Bible. I think that was the bit. I would have loved to just sit there and see how he would have broken down the text and made it plain for his people. It says, going further, verse 46, and he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But it tells us something. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Don't go all over the world. Don't go to foreign countries. Don't go to foreign lands. Don't go try to preach to other people until you have received power from above. That's clear instruction, my friend. That's clear instruction from the Word of God. Now let's go to the time in which they received this power. Go to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. And beginning at verse number 4. Acts chapter 1 and beginning at verse number 4. Please notice what the Bible says in Acts chapter 1, beginning at verse 4. It says, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Verse 7, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Okay, so this is real simple. God said, tarry here, don't go anywhere, until you receive power. This is the second time he said it. Until you receive power. Now, I want us to go Acts chapter 2. Watch carefully what we read now in Acts chapter 2 and beginning at verse number 1. Acts chapter 2 and beginning at verse number 1. The Bible says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Remember Jesus said? Just like the disciples knew, because Jesus was in heaven and he was anointed as high priest, they knew that transpired and they received the outpouring of God's Spirit in connection with his movement. So it is with those in these last days who follow Jesus into the most holy place. You see, Jesus is going to be anointed king, but he will not be anointed king until he has living saints who know by experience and have followed through the final tests. And have passed that test. And when they have passed that test, then they will be ready and have acknowledged Jesus as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You see, Satan has thrown a claim on you. Satan has thrown a claim on me. He says, you know what? I'm going to set my mark, which is a forced national Sunday law. I'm going to force my mark on you. And God says, I have the seal of God. Satan says, I'm going to put my mark out first, God, and I'm going to show you that there is nobody living who will live through that mark. I'm going to wipe everybody out, and everybody will bow down to my kingship and my sovereignty. And God says, no, no, I have a people. And I'm going to hold back those winds until I have a people that I can seal in their foreheads. And when they are sealed, my friends, he's going to pour out that rain, and the gospel is going to go to the world in such power and such force and such awesomeness. But friends, let me tell you, unless we make that choice today, we're not going to make it. You see, today is the preparation day. Today we need to prepare our hearts, our minds, and our souls to be in close union with God. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day we need to link up with the God of heaven and prepare for the crisis that is about to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise. Today is the day. I don't care what church you go to. If you're hearing this message, today is the day. Give everything to Jesus. Put everything on the line. The line is being drawn in the sand. Today, choose you this day who you are going to serve. But as for me and my house, we will continue to serve the Lord. You pray for me and I pray for you. You pray for me and I pray for you. The Bible says that he has a sickle in his hand. Tell me, what's a sickle for? Well, you only use a sickle to get a harvest. You only use a sickle to reap a harvest, which tells me that if there's a harvest, there must have been rain. God's character must have been demonstrated in his people. Friends, today, if you want Jesus to write his character in your heart, if you want to be on the winning side, you don't have to join me. I want you to join Jesus. If you want to be on the side of righteousness, I want you to get on your knees right now, and I'm going to get on my knees. I don't know if they give me permission to get on my knees here, but I'm going to get on my knees, and I'm going to ask God. I'm going to ask him to do something special for us today. This is my last time. I don't know if I ever see you again. I don't know if you ever hear my voice again. So I'm going to pray for you, and you're going to pray for me, and we're going to pray that we're on the right side. We're on God's side, the king's side, and the king has a seal, and his seal is the Sabbath. And that seal is not simply an outward observance. It's the seal of the heart where you die to self and Jesus reigns within. If that's your desire, kneel with me as we pray. As we seek God's mercy. As we seek his grace. Father in heaven. Lord, we want to thank you. Your plan of righteousness and your plan of salvation is so plain. Father, we need to be anointed today. Your spirit needs to dwell within our hearts, Father, but we have been in rebellion. We have fought against you, Lord. We have disrespected your law and your commandments. And Father, I just ask for forgiveness. I ask, Lord, that you make us clean from the inside out. I ask, Father, that you make us pure and holy and undefiled. Father, the enemy is coming against us like a flood, Lord, and we need your help. We thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. We thank you for giving us the wonderful gift of your spirit. We trust you, Father, and we ask that you teach us to trust you more. And we pray this in the name of Jesus and claim the merits of his blood. Amen. Friends, God bless you. And if I don't see you again on planet Earth, I want to meet you around that great white throne, that tree of life. At the feet of Jesus, God bless you, and Maranatha.